fuck, brother. Face with hard luck. Face with hard luck.
Pimps and card shots, thieves, murderers with hard luck. Pimps and card shots, thieves, murderers with hard luck.
We're east of Hollywood and near downtown. We have a lake that's been here since the 20s, when movie stars had love nests in the hills. Our homeboys take pride in telling the history of our barrio, because white people leave out a lot of stuff when they tell it. On Saturdays and Sundays, everybody shops at sunset in Echo Park Avenue. There's no reason to leave. You can get anything you need in my neighborhood. When I first moved here from Mexico, all the signs in the stores were in English, and I couldn't read them. Now there's as much Spanish.
Yeah, that's right. And you're tuning back into the Hard Luck Show. And we are continuing part two of the Mi Vida Loca story with Veronica Arellano and her husband, Mike.
You went right into that jazz smooth voice.
Yes, I did.
Welcome back.
Man, Veronica.
Hey, what's up?
Couldn't cut it short. We had to go into part two,
right?
Because it's amazing, amazing. And if you haven't already heard, please go back right now, listen to part one so that you can catch up. Just an amazing, wonderful, a very important story about this film going from concept, being turned into a major motion picture, and highly to do with Veronica. Just consulting, helping put this whole film together.
Essentially capturing a moment of time in Los Angeles and the culture, right?
Yes, definitely. That moment in time.
Where were we at exactly?
Well, we were at sort of, there was the premiere at the Cinedome.
Yes.
Yeah.
Jennifer Lopez was there. You didn't realize it was Jennifer Lopez. Right.
Trejo was there.
She realized it was Danny Trejo. I'm sure.
Issa Morales. Like right. The stars are coming out for this.
Right.
Let me ask you that night. So when you're obviously sitting in the theater and you've already seen it, you've already seen the film, but now you're getting to see it with an audience. Are you like, I wonder if they're gonna
I was like this, looking over my shoulder, behind, around, like just to see their reaction.
And so what how did it feel like the film was received by people that you look up to and your peers, and what was that like?
It was I can't even explain that feeling, just to know that that people were intrigued by it and amazed by this, like
glued to the screen,
yeah,
and right?
Right, yeah, because I always hear how this movie was, the authenticity of it was just like to the T, like from the dressing, the style of our hair, the makeup, and so just to see that on that big film and then looking at everybody's reaction was like, damn.
And what about, could you tell in sitting in that theater with all those folks, some of them were industry people, right?
Oh, yeah.
Like definitely. Producers and all this other stuff, right? Could you sense their energy and how they were reacting? Were they taking it in? Could you feel that?
They were stuck on the screen. They were really? Stuck on the screen.
Hell yeah. When
they were stuck on the screen, my head was going everywhere. He's seen it. I wonder who he is. He's seen it. Look. Because he was sitting right next to me.
What was it like sitting there next to her during this thing? Were you the guy holding the popcorn? Like, what was it going? What was going on? Red Vines?
No, it was just like exciting to see, because we had all the homeboys with us, so it was like we all went to the movies together. And then we see everybody up there, and we're like, it's kind of funny to see everybody that we know up on the screen.
Yeah.
It was exciting. Then we're looking around the audience and trying to see who we see. As far as like. Actors or celebrities.
So they let you bring the neighborhood up too.
Yeah, I think that was the highlight of the day of the premiere, was that part when we stepped out that van and you have all the camera people, the red carpet's there, and here come these thugs,
Right.
They're wearing their baggy 52 pants.
Yeah.
Button up
shirts. Crease down, yeah.
I have pictures of all that, man. I that's such a memory. That's something that I'm going to cherish and always.
You would have to.
Yeah.
I mean, this is something so special that you were a part of, man.
Yeah, we get off that van and all you see is the cameras turned this way. Boom, and lights and flashing. And it was like Echo Park in Hollywood,
Did you see the film, right? credits roll. Did you point at your name on the credits? You're like, no, there it is.
You want to say till you're waiting until that screen goes black. Yeah. You ain't moving nowhere. You want the whole credits
every
and everything.
Every time we've seen our names, I'd be like, hey, yeah.
And then afterwards, was there like a reception?
Yes, there was a reception. I don't remember. It wasn't too far from where we were at. I don't remember the hall it was at, but they had Lowriders in there. The That's in Cypress Hill was there. Lighter Shade of Brown.
Yeah.
Proper Dose, I believe, was there too.
Oh,
Ernie G.
Yeah. Yeah. Big shout out to
it
Ernie.
Was, it was really cool. Really cool to go into that.
Party right there at the Ivanhoe?
Ivanhoe, yeah.
Right there on, was it Fletcher?
No, that was the after party from the filming, but when we did the premiere.
Okay.
Yeah, there was two. So they had an after party in, what is that, Hyperion or Fletcher area? Los Feliz area, somewhere right there.
Yeah.
They had an after party.
Yeah, after did the get, after rap.
Did it get live at that
Yeah.
Yeah? You guys celebrated?
You like you hear that, though? It's like there was a handful of Latinos in the business, and they're all basically at this.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, dude.
Did you have any weird or strange or interesting conversations at the reception where people were coming up to you and they were talking to you and asking you questions and you were answering them?
No, I remember a lot of like, hey, good job, guys, you know, hopefully this takes you somewhere, or, you know, congratulations on the filming. And
yeah,
a lot of that was going on.
Celebrating it.
Yeah.
People were celebrating
it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. More celebrating it. Yeah.
And then after the reception, where do you go?
Back to the neighborhood.
What was the feeling with that? Were you guys going to continue on the celebration?
We continued partying in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And when did the party end that night?
I don't even know if it ever ended.
We're still partying.
Yeah.
But at some point, right, you go through this process and you're no longer, you are the same person, but you're not.
Yeah.
But everybody else who wasn't a part of the process is still the same person. What was it like going through regular life and all of that?
Good question.
In the neighborhood, it wasn't, I didn't get no different feeling from anybody because everybody had an opportunity to be in it if they wanted to. We gave everybody that chance. But nobody around the neighborhood or from the neighborhood didn't make me feel any different. Maybe like outside, like if people that knew that I did the film or came out in it, it was, oh, you're that girl, or oh, you came out of me, Vida Loca. How fun was it? I used to hear comments from, you know, ah, fuck that movie, and blah, blah, blah. What do you females know, or what do you broads know? Mm-hmm. Stuff like that. But it was like, whatever, just ignore it.
So there were some haters.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I think I have haters now.
Really?
Yeah.
Look at that, those eyes.
Yeah, I'm so, so hated.
Why?
Love it, though.
No, of course. But this we live in the age of loving your haters.
Yeah.
Right? Because you can't exist and do anything without haters.
Yeah.
But what is it that, what's the criticism?
A jealousy. Jealousy, and then it goes back because they don't know my story. Yeah. Oh, that movie's not about you. It's not about, well, that movie would have never been Mi Vida Loca if Vero would have never put herself out there. And, you know, it would
have. Damn, there you go. There you have it.
Because back then growing up, you don't publicize your life, right? Especially not that kind of style.
Right.
You don't do it.
Yeah, yeah.
And the fact that we did it, and we did it in such a respectful way where we weren't harming anybody else. Even the other gang, right? The opposite gang in the neighborhood, we made sure that don't call it what it actually was. Let's change it around.
Right.
But recognizable where people would probably know what we were talking about, you know?
Right.
Did you, that seems at an early time where navigating those rules, did you guys set a standard to a certain extent with that in the sense of you figured out what the blend was of we're not putting anything out there, at the same time, it's a little recognizable?
Yeah. We had to make sure that would happen because we didn't want it to, one, we're putting us on that screen, so we didn't want it to be something that was fake, something that wasn't us. We were going to keep it real. We're going to keep it real, but to an extent where it was respectful.
And you're not trying to bring somebody else into it. You guys made this decision to do this.
Yeah.
That doesn't necessarily mean that this neighbor or that neighbor wants to get dragged into it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It wasn't
conscious of that.
it was a rival neighborhood, so right, nobody right, got along.
Right.
But I think it's hard for people to understand, too, that it's a different media landscape than we have today. Today, it seems like so much more is accepted and out there, but back then,
you still had those guidelines.
It was totally different back then. Yeah, there was no internet, really.
No.
Like
no.
There is now, right?
No.
No YouTube.
Mm-mm. I don't even, sad to say, I don't even know that something like that could get done now. It would really, really be a real feat to try and get something like that done now.
Right.
If that makes any sense. It was a very special time, and that was probably what came out. And like, now it's just so convoluted in just so different many ways that it would be a million times more difficult to get a picture like that made and out, you know?
Right.
Just is. That's partly why it's just so special, you know?
Is there any merchandise that came from Mi Vida Loca that surprised you where you're like, oh, I can't fucking believe they made this?
Yeah. I see that iconic picture where it's the girl sitting behind a bomb. And I want to say it was a lady from Oregon that started it. I see it all over Etsy. And it's that everybody, you know, they would tell me, hey, did you see this shirt? Did you see this shirt? I was like, oh, what does this lady from Oregon know about maybe that right. Loca, right?
Right.
Like, what is she profiting off
of? Well, you kind of, so you said, or you were talking a bit about you and some of the other actors and actresses in the film were bound by contracts and couldn't do certain things to make money off of the film.
Yeah, I have my contract and I never looked at it. I just signed it. And so I don't know what the contract actually says, but I still have it to this day. But I know when we were talking, they weren't able to sign and do anything that had to do with the movie. And it was on their contract, which is why they never made any Mi Vida Loca merchandise. So when we started doing the meet and greets, I had a lot of my original pictures from the movie. Every time wardrobe change would happen, I would always tell the photo guy, can you take a picture? Take a picture of us. So I was always getting a picture. Well, it's in my hands. It's mine. Don't right. belong to them no more. Mm-hmm. So I started my meet and greets with my original pictures.
You start those?
About 6 years ago.
About six. So there was a pause in between.
Oh, yeah. Big pause.
A big pause that nobody was really reliving or sharing this with people?
No. It was in the lowrider scene. So there was like some people that were, you know, profiting off Mi Vida Loca, whatever mm-hmm. they made. I mean, nothing that you can't find off the internet.
Right.
But it wasn't until 6 years ago when I did that, when I met Angel, Sad Girl, at her meet and greet. And we sat down and had the conversation of having to do something.
Now, would you attribute some of this to the social media world as like an IG and stuff like that, that started to give you the opportunity and the communication lines and the platform to do stuff like this?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. What, if it wasn't for that.
What was, so let's get real. What was the reason for the pause?
Everybody just went doing their own thing. So they continued acting. There were actors. Christina was, I think, in a few shows for what is it, the Bundys, what's that show, Married the Bundys,
Married with Children. She was on that.
Yeah, she played Bud Bundy's girlfriend.
I like that show.
Yeah,
that was a good show.
She did a couple flushing. commercials. Angel was in Silverado and a couple other movies that she came out in. Mm-hmm. And then Sadie Lopez came out in, I think, one of those Fridays mm-hmm. right, with Jacob Vargas. And so they all continued their acting. Everybody, you know, then they got married, had kids, and mm-hmm. We all still stood in contact with each other,
mm-hmm.
But just never put ourselves out there. Angel was the one that started doing her meet and greets. She built a brand called Living Feed Me, and she started bringing us to these meet and greets with her. And we just all sat down and had that conversation, said, we got to do this. The fans are out there.
Yeah.
And they really are, because I looked at the YouTube comments, and there's thousands, hundreds of thousands, and they're all super supportive.
I can't figure out if it's the internet, if it's Instagram and social medias, and if it's time in itself, that's bringing back almost this revival of Chicano lifestyle. It's become so really popular.
Yeah.
It's become almost overly But it's become so popular that people are reaching back to almost, for one, they're reaching back to the 90s in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
But even above and beyond that, what was going on in Teen Angel magazine and Arte Lowrider, like these things are now on platforms, and there just seems to be all these young people that are obsessed with like Cortez's and that. So
My Pepsi sucks.
Yeah, I mean, and that's, but that also is adding to anything that was in that window is now being really, really like absorbed by people, and people, young people want to know all about that. So that's got to be adding the fuel to this thing and started helping it to grow, correct?
Definitely. I think all those platforms helped. Back in the days, I remember Teen Angel, and it was, you know, it was, I would look at the magazines and think, oh, that's just bad. Or,
right.
You see
right,
the car, right. That's how you knew where car shows were happening or what exactly. City the next car show is going to be at. Mm-hmm. But once social media came and it that really opened the doors for a lot of people everywhere, because now you're seeing people from Texas, Arizona,
right.
Chicago, New York, and they're into the style. And it's, for a minute, it was kind of bothering, it would bother me.
Why? Uh-huh. Why?
Because it's my life. Like, it's not a, for them, it's a style, it's a trend. For me, this right. was my life.
Right.
Look at, I'm 48 years old, I still wear my Nike Cortez. You know, it's my life, what I grew up, this is how I grew up dressing, you know, the clothes that I wear. So when I see, when I seen outsiders doing it, it was like, I used to get pissed off. You know, I was like, mm-hmm. you guys don't know what we went through dressing the way you're dressing, you know? Yeah. I was like, we went through hell and back. People died because they were wearing a certain color shirt or mm-hmm. jersey, the shoes, you know, you looked mm-hmm. a certain way. And then you see these people flashing it like, for, you know, to them it's just a lifestyle that they like, right. a style that they like.
Right.
Something it's they right. can put on and take off.
Yeah, yeah. It's a trend.
Yeah, a trend, definitely.
I think there was, I think even in the 90s, I think there were a lot of Hispanic Chicano people that were spread out all over the U.S., and they didn't have, they knew about it, but they didn't have access. There wasn't neighborhoods there. Mm-hmm. The only way they could find it was if they got their hands on a teenage, it was like, they were too far yeah. away, and it wasn't there in their hometown, but they aspired, they thought it was cool. And then with the internet and with social media, it almost delivered it.
Yeah.
And I think there was all these people that were into it, but had no access to it.
To it, yeah.
I feel
you
like,
know what I'm saying?
I feel like that's Instagram Jesus. I feel like he was far away.
He is. He was right? far away, but he was paying attention. He has old magazines.
Right.
Far before Instagram, he goes, I was following you guys, this article. That, and there was like certain little magazines and that you could find
yeah,
to like, find out more, but you really couldn't experience it. But social media right. internet has brought it. You could order the shit.
Yeah.
You could now you could like get in on the conversation. You could really study and get to know the people.
Right.
And that turned into what this is. And then along with that, you're going to get all the fakes.
Yeah.
That see that as a trend. Oh, now I want to, you know, and we're seeing some. That's part of the stuff that's bothersome.
Well, yeah. I want to ask you also, though, because, you know, what happens to you or your feelings when you start to, before the movie, and then some of the stuff that happens after the movie, and then what Big Lux just laid out about the studying it, right? At one point, you're not conscious that this is a style, right?
Yeah.
What mentally or emotionally goes through you as you watch this thing that is something that's just not even in your consciousness to now you're consulting and now you're becoming very aware of how you look?
I think it's when I seen throughout the news kids dying. There was these underground shows that were happening, party scenes for all ages, right? And kids were going dressed up like the way we would dress growing up, you know? Especially with those Charlie Browns, they're very famous mm-hmm. now.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
everybody wants to wear those. And
yeah.
That was really an eye opening for me. Like, wait a minute. I felt like you're making fun of us. I felt like you were just straight clowning us. Like, you know, then when you see the hipsters ones, right? Like dressing this way, it was like, right. wait a minute, people.
This is where I draw the lines yeah. with my hand.
You know,
up.
Like, I even put something on my Instagram a while back, spoke up on it. It's like, it's not, this is not a trend. It's my lifestyle.
Right.
I, you know, and it blew up. It was so much controversy. People were like, well, that's not fair. You know, kids this and kids like to dress. I'm like, I don't give a shit. I'm not seeing it from their perspective of being a trend. I'm seeing the danger that it's causing and creating. Right, and right, that's right, what right. you guys don't realize. Like,
right.
it's cool to dress like it. Okay, if you're going to go to a party, whatever. But be aware of your surroundings when you leave that party. Because right. I guarantee you, wherever you're going to be, there's always going to be something that's going to happen.
Something comes along with that.
Yeah.
You know, what you're talking about, though, really touches me personally because I see the same thing with American Indians. And it's weird because American Indian stuff, right? It's real old.
Oh, yeah.
And then you see it sort of commodified. And then people wearing or doing stuff, cheerleaders with fucking neon rainbow headdresses and all that shit, right? And it starts to make you feel like you feel with the hipsters, which is like, wait a second. And, but then at the same time, you don't want, at least me, I'll speak of me, I don't want to necessarily be the person that tells people you can't do this and you can't do that. But at the same time, I don't know how to convey properly to people that this wasn't a commodity. This wasn't a retail item, right? It was, a lot of times, Big Lux, when you talk about some of the stuff that you guys did, it was stuff that was just available. And then you made it your own or you did something with it. But it wasn't something that you knew was going to be some sort of interesting commodity for folks later who had a lot of distance from it mm-hmm. and were doing it to make a statement or whatever sure. it was.
Yeah.
Sure.
How, at this stage now where you're at, how do you feel about it or what are your thoughts about how to make it, at least keep it tethered to where it really came from?
I started doing YouTube videos with one of my friends, Chino Los Angeles, who's my photographer, mm-hmm. and Boulevard Juice. He wanted to bring awareness to the community, right? Because a lot of kids were dressing the way we dressed growing up, but they weren't from gangs. And he's from the East LA area. So he's seen also a lot of stuff that happened on that side. And we were sharing stories. He's like, we gotta do something about this. Let's bring awareness and talk about it. So we started interviewing people that were actors, singers, and getting their perspective on it. Because I don't know if you guys are familiar with Mona from Japan. She's a sad girl, she's a rapper. Uh-huh. Really huge out there.
Hmm.
And really good friend of mine. And they put my story out there first about talking about the trend, what I felt. And I'm going to be honest and blunt with everybody.
Yeah.
You know, it's, I do it because it's first, it's coming from my heart.
Right.
So I lived it, seen it, witnessed a lot of that happened because of the way we grew up dressed and looked, right? Not just the dying, but the profiling, racial profiling with the
sure.
police.
Sure. Right.
That was like the biggest thing, you know, like you don't know what we lived and you don't know what we went through because of the way we looked. Mm-hmm. And here you mm-hmm. guys are playing Barbie, dress up dolls and.
Right.
You think it's cute, but in reality, it's not like that. So right. when I go to shows and I see kids, I always ask the young girls, can I ask you what made you, what do you like about the style that you
right.
dress this
right.
way?
Because right.
I want to get everybody's point of view. I'm
sure.
I'm trying to be open-minded, right, and understandable, but like.
That's because you're a good person. I'm a terrible
well,
person.
Well, I mean, I want to be me. No, I want to be me.
I'm mean.
I'm biting my tongue, and the inside right, of my head, I'm right, like, right, right. bitch, yeah. you know?
Oh, and what made you don on this outfit?
Yeah. So, you know, so I hear their stories, and a lot of it is I remember seeing my mom
right.
my aunt, you know, cousins dressing this way, and I
right.
liked it. Okay. And then the mother instinct comes out of me. Do you realize the consequences when you're out in an area that you're not familiar with and you're dressed this way? Do you like stop to think something could happen? Somebody might mistake me to be somebody from a different gang. And that catches their attention like right away because they don't think of it.
Yeah. And I think that something that we live in today, people's experience with being outside is different than it was.
Yeah.
Like, I don't think we have the same amount. When we were coming up, we spent more time outside.
Absolutely.
Right. So you would.
Not on these all day long, living through this shit.
Yeah.
You were experiencing real life.
That's what they live. Yes, yeah. exactly.
So And without even putting a value on it, right? The reality today, though, is based on how dangerous it is out there, based on COVID, monkeypox, whatever the fuck is going on, right? Most people are more inside now, and there's more stuff to do internally, so they might not have the social awareness that you're talking about.
And they don't.
And they don't. And there, there's a quote, I forget it, but... You can gain all the information you want. Doesn't mean you know something. Just because you experience allows you to really understand, to really know. You can understand stuff through the internet there, but you would have to experience to actually know what it is.
Yeah. Right.
And there's a difference there.
Yeah.
There's a huge difference there. And I think that's where it gets convoluted. What I, you know, listen, I'm in the apparel world, you know, and I've been, I've made a career and a life out of building brands. And early on mistakes with trademarking and, you know, copywriting, different things. And I've struggled. I mean, we lost brands that were heavily invested in because we didn't have proper trademarking.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't. So my question to you is, I know, and I met you on the premise of walking up to your retail booth, your brand. Tell us how you were able to get, how were you able to get me, Vida Loca, turn this into a brand? When did that happen? And what's the brand up to now? And like, tell me about this, because you guys do a lot of dope stuff.
I wanted to stick with the Chicano culture and still keep that 80s, 90s vibe going. And I only had my pictures, and that's how I started vending. Was my pictures, and I would autograph them. I started off with one picture, 4x6, and a sticker of Mi Vida Loca. So in the beginning of the movie, you see the heart intro, right? It's a heart with the Mi Vida Loca. So during the premiere, they gave us stickers like that, and this is was a sticker.
Okay.
But in the middle, it said Allison, director Allison Anderson, and then the bottom it said My Crazy Life. Mm-hmm. I revamped the sticker, changed, you know, took that out, and made it mine. And so this was my first design, but it's actually in color. It's red and like a royal blue.
Okay.
And I started with the pictures, and I saw, you know, people were coming, buying it. And it really blew my mind because, like I said, during that whole time that all these years passed by, I didn't know the fan base. I didn't know the people that were out there.
Right.
And I didn't know that anybody knew me. I'm like, really?
Because you had no access to them. Nothing. And they had no access to you.
Nothing.
Right.
So when I met them, when I would meet them face to face in person, like, oh my God, Vero. And Angel and Baby Doll, they're always sharing my life and my story. So I didn't know that this whole time, because they were sharing my life and story, my name was growing. My face was out there. I was known. And so when I would meet these people, it was like, you know, they already knew who I was, and it was mind-blowing for me. So when I came out with my pictures and they were asking for my autograph, buying it, I'm like, okay, should I charge a little more? What do I do? Always a thing, right?
Go and ask Big Lux about that. He knows how to price
all
that
shit out.
So I
started off a picture, $5 with a sticker. That's right, it, right?
Right.
Then I started doing, you know, 2 years went by, and I was like, okay, I started off with this shirt, and then a script writing that just says, Mi Vida Loca. And those were my shirts for the first 2 years that I was doing my brand. And when I seen people buying, I was like, man, these people really like... It was drawn to that movie. They really liked what was, you know, anything that had to do with Mi Vida Loca. So then my mind's going, and I'm like, I'm very... I love, how can you say it? I love arts and crafts. I don't know how to draw, but I know... And my ideas in my head, and I'll tell the person, like, this is what I want, you know, or my husband, because he would draw or do tattoos, right?
Yeah.
So I started, being in the industry, I got to know a lot of amazing people that already had their foot in the door, and then already had their brand built, and they would give me advice, and I would seek their advice, because, like, I want to give back, and I want my brand to be noticeable and capture that 80s and 90s theme, you know, that authenticity of it. And I think it was my fourth year, somebody had put a comment on one of my pictures, and they said, thank you for bringing the 80s back. I was like, oh. she recognized what I was trying to do with my clothing, you know. And that's what I wanted people to see, that stuff that, you know, so it's eye-catching to me. I want it to be eye-catching to them.
Why do you think people want the 80s or the 90s to come back? What is it about those goddamn
years?
Why?
God, besides the drugs, but... Let's be real. I was, you know, I was high on the set most of the time, but... I don't know what everybody just really loves the... I don't know if it's the bagginess of the clothes because they feel comfortable or... I can't... For me, it was, like I said, it was just my style. So it's hard for me to explain.
Right.
I get like the 90s and I was part of it. And But truly what I'm really, really into is 80s. I'm more into 80s. Like it was the mid and late 80s that was like.
What would you describe are the qualities of the 80s or the design aspects of the 80s?
You just like the Pendletons, the flannels. The licensed gear, like that shit, like, it was really like what you were really dressing up to wear that shit. It was almost like in the 90s, it changed. It got really big, white t-shirts, ball head, but it was like the 80s was like almost like hairnets and fucking house shoes and
still slicking that hair back.
Yeah,
right?
Dude. And it was just
no
like,
bald head.
No bald head. And it was like Raiders and Kings and corduroy hats. And like, it was just like, it was, you know, it was those first Raider jackets with the letters, the starter jackets. It wasn't the puffy ones yet. It was like old school coach jackets outside. And that was just like, it was gangster, man. Yeah. That shit was real gangster. Yeah.
Raiders, the colors was the big thing back then.
Like, absolutely.
And to this day it is now. So this is my new design. And my husband came up with the colors. He's like, we got to capture what they're going to like, gray and black.
Right.
Raider colors. Yeah, right. There's a lot of Raider fans out there. So this is my new design, the one he's wearing right now for my men's. And it's a big
It was
hit.
Almost like if you were brown, you were a Raiders fan.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
But I used to have a Raiders jacket. I mean, a jersey. Yeah. I only wore it because of colors.
Right. Yep.
That was it.
It was really like, and the 90s kind of took all that, but it was kind of like at the 90s, the companies already started getting hip to like, oh, those are, in the 80s, you were wearing it and it wasn't, they weren't aiming it at you. You had to go get it.
Right. Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, I totally
By
do.
The 90s, they had already figured out, we're going to start aiming at swap meets. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It was just different.
And in the 90s, for a girl growing up then, you see a guy walking, bald head guy, or a guy with hair slicked back in a brand new white t-shirt. You're like, damn, that's eye candy.
Yeah. It was just different. It was just more. It was even
Mike
more.
Mike is shaking his head. He's like, I don't need to hear these stories. Yeah. Come on, Veronica.
You know, that's
we got
like,
a long drive home,
him.
Baby.
I like the 80s. So what's going on today? What's going on with you? So you have the brand out. Where do people find the brand?
I have my Etsy store right now, Mi Vida Loca brand on Etsy. And I'm also on Instagram at Vero Echo Park. I have Mi Vida Loca brand also on Instagram, but I'm more active on the Vero Echo Park one.
Okay.
But yeah, my Etsy store is right now. It's thank God it's a really big... I have a really big fan base on it.
That's great.
I was really, really blessed. I had to just recently put my store on vacation mode because I couldn't keep up with orders.
That's great, man.
I do a lot of car shows too. So, you know, inventory in between. And then it was like, I told my husband, I have to go on vacation mode. I have to give myself a rest, you know, a couple weeks.
I love that you've made this thing work for you, that you've been able to capture it and continue to make it work for you. I know that you also outside, above and beyond, listen, listeners, go check out Mi Vida Loca brand. Go get something over there, okay? Support the cause. But above and beyond clothing, I know that you're still active in working community at a community-based level. Tell us a little bit about that, where you're at.
Right now I work for the homeless population. I'm an outreach coordinator, and I get homeless families, individuals, house them, try to get them employed, get them into a program if they're struggling with addiction. Mm-hmm. I've been doing that for maybe the last 10 years.
Wow.
Prior to that, I used to do gang intervention, and that's where my heart was back then, working with a lot of at-risk youth, even youth that were rival neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. I had a big part in 2014. I was given a Peace Builder Award for bringing three rival neighborhoods together. And calling a truce for a while. And that was my hardest moments then, because my husband didn't like me then. Mm-hmm. We didn't get along during that time. He didn't like the work I did. He didn't like the people I was surrounded, the people that I was helping. But he saw them for what they were, and I saw them. I saw like that inner kid in them, you know, that kid that didn't grow up yet. They were stuck, and my motherly instincts came out, and I had that need, and I felt the need to help them.
Mike, what was it that for you that made it difficult to be with Veronica through that process?
Well, because I knew, like, a lot of the guys, because growing up in the neighborhood, you see a lot of them that are going through problems and stuff like that, and they use people. You know, they see somebody that's going to help them, and they'll take what they can get and go back to their ways.
Right.
So I didn't necessarily hate what she did, but I felt like you're just wasting your time. But she would tell me, if I could just help one, that's good enough. So I'm like, I had to support her in that way. But it's still hard because I see, like, we've taken in kids and we helped them out, and they turn around and, like, F you, you know? And it pisses me off because she puts her heart into it, and they turn around and do her dirty.
You want to see her get taken advantage of.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Veronica, does it hurt you at all when that happens?
It does.
Because your heart's in it.
Yeah, I know. I'm proof of change. He's proof of change. And sure. I know it could happen.
Right.
You know, you just, and I get them for that moment. Mm-hmm. And I have them, and I'm like, fuck yeah, I did this. I'm giving mm-hmm. you something. I'm giving life back to you. That's how I feel. Like, I'm giving you life back. Right. And when they turn on me, it hurts me, and I hide it. I have a really good way of hiding it.
Right.
And, you know, I'll have my moments and I'll cry and whatever. But it's like I tell him, if I can just save that one, that's all I want, is just to save that one. And I have. Mm-hmm. I had a few that died on me, but it was at least I know that I gave them that opportunity for change.
Is this partially, I mean, is this somewhat motivated out of losing Nika?
Yeah. She had a really big part in the work that I do. I went as far as to going to be a substance abuse counselor.
Yeah.
And after a while, as I got to get more into the field and get to know people, it was hard to try to tell an adult, stop getting high, right? Sure. And all I can do was educate them. Mm-hmm. I also worked with youth doing substance abuse, and to me that was a lot more easier because I was able to bring them reality, and I would bring all my like, what are those from, like, any funerals that I went to, and I had a shitload. I'd come in a big box, I lay it out on the table, their pictures were there, t-shirts, whatever it was that they had made, and it would be just a silent moment for the kids, and I would tell them, just focus on the pictures and read, you know, whatever you want, and I'd give them like about a half hour, and we talk about it, and it was an eye-opening for the kids, and it was easier to try to get them to change mm-hmm. opposed to working with an adult. But right. Nika was a big part of why I stumbled into the road, and I continued doing it, and just trying to help out the next one that didn't have the strength or the opportunity to walk away from it the way I did.
I can agree. I mean, I've definitely dealt with people in the lifestyle and the addiction all mixed up into one, mm-hmm. and you help somebody to move away from that, and then you see them and you see that light go off and you're like, yeah, and then you watch that person go back, and then a lot of times that person doesn't make it back out, they die.
Yeah.
And it's devastating, man, especially when you've gotten to the point where you see the light go off.
Yeah.
And you're like, wow, and they get it, and you get it.
Yeah.
And then to see somebody regress, and I've had a couple very, very close friends. And there's the fuck you part too, but they almost need to do that in order to justify going back to what they know or whatever that might be. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The psychology. Somebody's got to be the fucking point the finger at.
Yeah.
In order to enable you to take the easy road out. You know, there's a lot of different dynamics, but I think you getting emotional, I mean, there's a lot to it because you want to save everybody, you know? You want people to get it. And don't you see, or, you know, and it's not, the reality of it is not everybody's going to.
No. And it wasn't, I remember when I first started doing the gang intervention and one of the first kids that, you know, died on me and it was heartbreaking. And I remember talking to my mom and she's like, you know, Veronica, as long as I can remember since you were in junior high, you always had kids run away and come home with you. I don't know what it was about me, but it was, and I didn't realize it till she had told me, and I'm already in my mid-20s, probably early 30s. And she's telling me this, and I thought back from when I was in junior high, even elementary, because Nika was one that would stay in my home. But I would always have runaways at my house, and I would make sure to call the parents and let them know, your daughter, your son's here, don't worry, they don't want to go home, but here's my phone number, here's my mom, you know, talk to my mom. So their parents knew they were safe.
Right.
And but when my mom told me that, it was like, damn, this was my destiny. This was
right. You've been doing this.
Yeah. I had been doing it and not realizing. And when I started doing it for work, and I gave it my all, everything that I could to try to save, you know, just that one and help somebody out. And that's what I do now.
Did you struggle with addiction yourself?
Not addiction. I used to get high. I after Nico passed away, I was the homegirl that never got high. I used to drink, but I was the homegirl that always took care of them when they were partying and getting high. And when she passed away, I was high. I lost it. I didn't know. I woke up, my wrist was slit, and I didn't know. I didn't cut it through all the way. So thank God. I just remember waking up to my brother smacking me in my face, you know, trying to wake me up. And I think after that was, okay, that was it. I partied for like 2 years. You know, PCP was my drug of choice. Yeah.
That's a big one.
Yeah.
That's Man. Not like a little bit of a bammer weed.
Yeah, for being my first choice of drug, PCP. I just went right into it.
Right.
But you know what? Veronica Arellano.
Yes.
I want to just say, this is amazing having you on. It's your story is just incredible. You know, I mean, we could sit and talk for hours about just a lot. And I'm hoping that we're going to have you back on the show eventually. Come and visit us.
Definitely.
Mike, you too. just such
you
an...
You too, Mike.
Yeah, Mike. Oh, that's you too. Mike's going to jump on the mic a little more next time too. But just an incredible... I'm just so fascinated with your story. I'm so impressed with what you've done. I find your life so far so special. You know, and so much more yet to go. You've just really uncracked so much, and I just see so much unveiling. And it's almost like I look at you as almost a spokesperson in many ways for our culture.
Yeah.
And I'm just so, so happy that we got to do this show, got to revisit some things, get to hear the real background story, all these questions I had and things I wanted to know about the making of this film and how it went down and the effect and how it affected me and so many people I know, you know, and it's just great having you in here and great. I just appreciate you so much, you two, coming down, sharing an important part of history in your lives with us, you know, over the show. It's dope. It's
You're
great.
You're welcome. I'm glad I'm able to share. Like, it's not even all of it. Like I said,
there's
still the police issues and stuff that I went through.
I want you real quickly to, we'll bring you in for part three. Don't trip.
No.
But let our guests know one more time where they can find out more about you and where they can purchase your products.
Okay. So my Etsy store is on Etsy under Mi Vida Loca brand. And then you can find me on Instagram at Vero Echo Park. That's the one that I'm most active on. And then I also have my Mi Vida Loca brand page on Instagram.
There you go. You got it. So go check out her page. Go check out some dope, iconic stuff from the film. Make a purchase. I'm going to. And And yeah, keep on checking in. It's a pleasure having both of you here tonight.
Thank you.
Juman, what you got?
Ovando Bowen, LLP. We wear braids to court. Let the tomahawks fly. The best legal representation that money can buy.
Sean Lewis?
Sean at movemental.media. For all, every single one of your audio needs.
And maybe some other needs, ladies.
You never know.
Right?
Throw, yeah. Come on. Yeah. Also, don't forget to hit us up at www.hardluckshow.com.
Right.
Check out the Mercado tab.
Right. At the Mercado.
Mercado.
Right. Hablas Espanol?
What did I say?
You sounded like a white boy saying okay. Mercado.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Well, because I am a white boy.
Market. No, you're not.
I'm not?
What are you?
I'm a white boy. Okay. And don't forget Gumroad, hls.gumroad.com.
All right. www.supermaxhardware.com. Come check us out. Check out Summer. Just dropped. And get yourself a tank. Maybe a snapback. Also, Cookies at Cookies SF for, you know, some good apparel and some good cannabis flower. And Vibes Rolling Papers at Vibes Papers. Check it out. And with all that, once again, mi vida loca. Veronica, thank you for coming in.
Yeah.
Thank you for having me.
Yes. Hasta la vista. Adios from the Hard Luck Show. We're out.
Junkies are the worst kind, eh? We're too weak for the life. Got the nice pad to live in. Always had it nice. Got a bedroom just for them and their shit. Not sharing with no one. Then they get greedy.